iPad just ran out his welcome. The videos on Aaron were great for one reason, besides sending himself into a frenzy and making him maniacally pace back and forth like a psycho. Which is that it deflected attention away from all of us for a hot minute when we needed it.
Come join us on the premium channel. I'll also vet you for that. There'll be no haters, no losers, no jerks, no idiots, no eye patches. Okay. I'm 66 years old. If any fetuses want to take me on, I will ignore you as long as I can. And then I will kick your
This song right here is dedicated to Dewmonic Piss.
Straight from the Mafia.
And you're like mad at random Rockafire Mafia people who don't ever do anything to you and don't ever engage in internet drama.
I'm mad at the grown fucking man who called a 14-year-old girl cute. That's what this all...
It's kind of weird, but I'm not like...
It is kind of weird.
Hold the fuck, say that again.
A man in his fucking 40s calling a 14-year-old girl cute.
Quote unquote kind of fucking weird, what?
Mr. Ferguson, alright. You need to go fucking sober. This isn't the first time something like this has happened, and I doubt it'll be the fucking last.
Without giving away too much, if one of us pushed them, we'd probably end up in a legal battle because we've pushed Aaron to the limit already. Damon's already in the situation, and it has as much to do with the trolling, because you guys do a little too much trolling, as it does with anything Smitty's related. I mean, we all laughed at dudes' videos at first, because they had utility. We still laugh at him, albeit for different reasons, because he's sexy. But it's been a mafia pawn. He's been a big mafia pawn for day one. An unwitty one, but the best puns always are.
You might be surprised by the amount of drama, chaos, and downright degeneracy coming from a community built on the nostalgia of singing, dancing robotic animals. And me, despite being waist deep in this cesspool, I'm right there with you. When I saw David Ferguson attempted to use his Rockafire show to get a topless photo of a 14-year-old girl, I was sick to my stomach. It wasn't something I was necessarily surprised by, but it didn't make it any easier to process. All these questions kept coming up over and over again, like bubbles in a vigorously rattled case of Mountain Dew. How many members of the Rockafire Mafia knew about this? How could this man, so well respected in the community, with a loving wife and daughter, stoop to such a low level? I knew this was a battle I was going to have to fight eventually. I knew it deep down in my fucking soul. And, to be honest, it was one I came into heavily, heavily unprepared. I guess I might as well start from the very beginning. How I ended up in the crosshairs of some of the most, quote-unquote, powerful people in the Rockafire community. Well, on July 7th, 2021, an anonymous source sent me a concerning screenshot from a Rockafire Mafia group chat. The screenshot in question displayed David Ferguson under the alias Tabs Left Tit. I mean, I know that's the epitome of class right there. And in this screenshot, he's calling a 14-year-old girl cuter than Mitzi. As Pikalove pointed out in the voice chat, that was in reaction to this 14-year-old in a Mitzi cosplay. And as many in the public discourse have discussed, there are varying degrees of semantic dispute regarding the word cute. There's one half of the community that agrees it's an inappropriate remark for a 43-year-old man to be making about a 14-year-old girl. The other half of the community was willing to give David, I guess what you consider to be the benefit of the doubt. Some arguments I've heard are,
He could have been referring to her as cute like someone would refer to a pet as cute. And others have pointed out that he has an edgy sense of humor, that he might have just told a horrible joke behind closed doors. I get it. I've been there too. Not to fucking the extent of him making this remark about a minor, but I get it. I have a dark sense of humor. I get that argument. Now, in my opinion, this screenshot by itself was not going to be worth an Instagram post or expose video. Hence it being about 3 months later that I'm now bringing this up on my channel. To me, this screenshot was supposed to be a lead, not definitive evidence. I was going to use this screenshot to investigate whether or not this was a red flag for predatory behavior. But as will be elaborated later on in the video, this investigation was unfortunately leaked to the public due to a former member of my team who went rogue and snitched on me to the mafia. Our intentions were good, I can assure you that 100%, but our hand had been forced and the situation turned messy, for lack of a better word. Hence the public discourse happening in the first place. Well, I'm gonna clear the air right now and say that this whole semantic dispute over the word cute has ultimately been completely fucking worthless. Throw that all into the trash because a former member of the Rockafire Mafia was bravely willing to step up and show further alarming context of the group chat. As you can see in this now updated screenshot, Ferguson doubles down on the point, much to the surprise of the other members in the group chat. Him saying she got some special tang to her clearly debunks the argument of it being a wholesome compliment. Our source also revealed that Ferguson has been in private contact with this same 14, now 15-year-old girl within the span of a few months now. When Funfair and I questioned the girl, she would forward over a message of David attempting to solicit a topless photograph of her in exchange for four of her selected favorite Rockafire shows live back to back. We would like to ask that the victim remain anonymous, as this girl does not deserve the harassment that will undoubtedly come her way from members of the Rockafire Mafia. I mean, I'm sure they already know her identity, because David has talked about her extensively in their group chats, but if there's any way for me to quell that bandwagon, you know, this is my show of good faith. Please do not seek this person out. Members of the community that know the victim in question have described her as an innocent, vulnerable, sweet girl that loves the Rockafire explosion. You know, she's frequently uploading dancing videos and cosplay pictures, which others have pointed out. Ferguson has liked a lot of these dancing videos on his public social media account and even left what I consider to be flirtatious comments on a few of her pictures. It is of the opinion of myself and my team that David was willing to exploit slash manipulate this young girl's love for the Rockafire to try and solicit this child pornography. There's really no other way of saying it. There is absolutely zero excuse for a 43-year-old man to be getting or trying to get a shirtless picture of a child. I realize that the Rockafire explosion is a community filled with minors. I do wish that schools would take a more proactive approach in teaching kids the very real dangers of social media, the kind of tactics adults will use to manipulate people, and honestly how to properly handle situations like this. Funfair Ordnance has been a very vital member of our team. They've studied police interrogation tactics, the warning signs of predatory behavior, and is someone in our community people feel comfortable opening up to. I'm very thankful for the amount of work they've put into this case, and I want to give them a shout out for that. I realize that we can be in a position of pointing a finger at someone and saying, oh, this person's a creep, call him out. But having proper awareness is ultimately what's going to help prevent things like this from happening again in the future. So with that being said, we want to explain the basics of situational offenders, how they operate, and how some of the behaviors line up with how Ferguson has been acting. So I'm going to let Funfair take the reins on that.
Hello everyone, my name is Klaus, and now allow me to explain. I'm a sexual abuse survivor, and as such, I'm very keen on what classification David falls under while grooming. David is a dangerous individual, that I can confirm. The information I'm going to be presenting is based on what I've seen as an outsider, and I'm going to be shortly and promptly breaking this down in the most professional way I can due to the serious subject matter. The proper terminology is situational offender. Situational child groomers are usually socially equipped, which is debatable in this case, since introverted individuals with a very low self-esteem, as quoted by the activist Justin Payne. Once they are confronted and called out for their behavior, they will deny any and all involvement or sickly try to justify or rationalize their actions and attempts at child exploitation. This usually involves sending the minor any form of adult media, making suggestive or sexual comments in the attempts to normalize it, or they will try to befriend the child or shower them with things that perhaps their life is lacking. Dangers like David will try any way to cover their tracks, deflections, tantrums, and even reverse psychology. Mind games are very popular for these men, as it's seen he has been twisting the narrative onto someone else. A clear sign of projection. That's all I really have to say on this matter. See ya.
彼らの意図は似ていますが、彼らが稼ぎたいものは異なり、性的なチャットだけで彼らを満足させるかもしれません。彼が他の人には無実に見えるかもしれない子供の写真にアクセスできる場合、彼はそのコンテンツを使用してそれをさらに何かにねじることができます。深い聴衆の両親、私たちはあなたの子供たちの電話とコンピューターをチェックするように頼みます。そして天国は彼らが無制限にインターネットにアクセスすることを禁じています。これらの男性は最初はそうするつもりがなかったとしても、あなたのコミュニティに参加してあなたの子供にアクセスすることができます。モンスターはまだ子供たちの中にいます。彼らが犠牲者を追い詰めた後に現れる非常に無責任で取り返しのつかないモンスター。私はあなたを私の友人に返します。ドゥーモニックアビス。
I think it's fair to make the assumption that anyone involved in that Rockafire Mafia group chat, who hasn't come forward, by the way, there was one that I can name, that hasn't come forward with a statement denouncing David's actions or even defending him. They were a willing participant in trying to cover this up and hide it from the public eye.
This all started with this broad Pikalove. Her real name is Tabitha. You know, the broad whose literal ass the entire community roasted because of me? Yeah, her. Pika is someone who knows how to infiltrate many different online circles and knows how to sell herself, a credible threat in a battleground of public opinion. She has sought out moderator status in many different servers, some of which were even a conflict of interest. Example, being a moderator in both the Dewmonic Abyss and Cavity Sam servers, while there was drama between the communities. As far as allegations go, Pikalove has betrayed so many different circles and burnt so many different bridges that it's counterintuitive to pinpoint her as one specific faction member. She is self-serving and willing to throw anyone under the bus to achieve perceived power and doubt in the animatronic fandom. She's an active participant of the Rockafire Mafia group chats. Sounded smart? Great, because Dewmonic Abyss wrote that bit. Anyway, here's a timeline written by yours truly. Dew receives a screenshot of David calling a 14-year-old girl cuter than Mitzi, and I'm going to keep this source anonymous. So Dew posts the screenshots in a private group chat, which has since been wiped clean by Franker the Wanker. Tabitha was in the Mafia group chat that the screenshot originated from, and as a result just lost what little marbles she had left. She runs back to the Mafia, exposes the fact that Dewmonic Abyss had a lead on David and was speculated and investigating the possibility of David being a predator, exposing his lead to the person he's investigating. David is now slightly on edge. As a result, Dew removes Pikalove's moderator status in his Discord server, and rightfully so. Pika finds out that she's been unmodded and goes scorched earth. She collects a load of mods who were too young and manipulable to think otherwise and convinces them that Dewmonic Abyss is evil somehow. She convinces them to spam the server with junk until Dewmonic eventually shuts the server down for nearly a week. There were only three moderators that didn't change sides. Dewmonic sniffs out the rogue moderators in a voice channel together, and I jump in like the badass that I am and confront the rogue mods. I assert dominance by insulting the kids so they remain silent while I talk, then I begin going in on Pika with the Flatty Patty jokes. Her reaction was noteworthy enough that Flatty Patty unintentionally became a meme. Then I talk business. I bring Pika to a private voice channel with me and Dewmonic Abyss only. This is where this famous clip happened.
And you're like mad at random Rockafire Mafia people who don't even do anything to you and don't even engage in internet drama.
I'm mad at the grown fucking man who called a 14-year-old girl cute. That's what this all stems from.
It's kind of weird, but I'm not like...
It is kind of weird.
Hold the fuck, say that again.
A man in his fucking 40s calling a 14-year-old girl cute.
Quote unquote, kind of fucking weird. Like what? Kind of fucking weird. No, he deserves a bullet.
What?
A grown 40-year-old fucking man calling a 14-year-old cute? Question mark. Is that what I heard?
What the photo was is Braylon, one of the members, is a teenager, just shared an image of some girl, and he said it was cute. That's literally it. He did not DM anyone. I said, how does he even
okay,
know
the person who shared this picture?
He could have literally just said it was a cute outfit. It's not Bobby DMing girls saying you're pretty hot.
Okay, I'm just going to strip this down to the basics.
Okay.
The person who sent the image.
The person who sent the image who is totally not Anthony Ibarra, which...
And you can see other people in that group chat have the same fucking reaction I do. Person responding him says, you're fucking joking. Thumbs down on that comment. How else are you supposed to take it?
Okay, so the person who sent that is 40?
Yeah, this is a grown man.
And the person in the picture is like 14?
Something like that. I don't think she has her age, so we don't know how old.
Okay, okay.
Random girl.
Like, whoever that is makes Pete Fox look like a fucking American hero. No, that's disgusting.
Are you fucking kidding me?
Exactly, it's fucking disgusting. That's why I voted.
Of course I'm fucking kidding you.
You would be on board with that.
Pete Fox would never look like a hero.
Do you know what Pete does? Do you know what he does to people?
I know because I was one of them.
Okay.
You must have forgot who the fuck Serena Wilkes is.
Trying to meet up with me.
In the video, she clearly states that it is kind of weird, but later down the line, she states, by that logic, if you've ever called a pet cute, you're a zoophile. Clearly backing down on her previous train of thought and going full defense for David. Me and Dumana tracked down all of the mods that went rogue except Franker and Pika. And said mods proved their allegiance after learning the whole story. The community bands back together once Dewmonic brings his server back online, and they began expanding my Flatty Patty remark into a series of memes. That extended lower back, that's a flat ass patty. During the trolling, I briefly used the Serena Wilkes Instagram account, which I was attempting to use to catfish David, to troll Pika. She exposes that I'm behind the Instagram account, but try to make me out to look like a predator myself, simply because the catfish account is following a shitload of minors. The hypocrisy was quickly pointed out by multiple members of the community, saying that she herself follows well over 1,000 people on Instagram, and a good chunk of them are minors. At this point, she had already accused me of being a racist and a sexist. Pete Fox, who I was actively catfishing at the time, had deleted Instagram weeks before this happened, so he wasn't yet aware I was a catfish. However, I was communicating with him on Discord, and I got lucky enough to get a call with him while I was recording my voice readings of the Pete Fox messages. In another community server, she is found straight up dogging on another member of Dew's mod team, who she had no previous involvements with up until this point, regarding her preferred pronouns. Her hypocrisy in calling me a sexist soon backfired from this, and she found herself leaving the server over it. She allegedly made fake accounts, which she denies having made, that, I don't mean a few little accounts here and there. I mean, there are hundreds of attempts to breach Dew's server under at least 20 different accounts made in the same day over the course of a week. If the accounts are not made by her, they're at least connected to her. One account pretending to be Dewmonic Abyss straight up admits that she's behind it by asking for her mod status back. The same one tried convincing Sayori that...
She actually thinks this fucking excuse, "Hey, my old account got deactivated for some reason," it is gonna work on people that I'm talking to pretty much every fucking day. They can smell bullshit like this coming a mile a fucking away. Her excuse is, right, Sayori says, "Why'd your account get deactivated?" I told too many lies about Tabitha Griffin in DMs, alright? Actual fucking child shit, alright? This is a 21-year-old woman acting like a fucking grade schooler.
Another was found in a server pretending to be me until I confronted it. The fucking Ultron bots die down for a hot minute, and Pika for the most part gets weeded out of majority of the animatronic community servers. Then shit winds right back up over her making the allegation that Dewmonic Abyss is a pedophile. This sets Dewmonic Abyss off. He publicly threatens her to direct message him or he's dropping shit on her and her mafia friends. She doesn't respond. In hindsight, she may have straight up just been asleep, but we don't negotiate with terrorists. So Dew begins dropping bombs on the mafia through Instagram. After a while of no word from Pika, Dew stops his carpet bombing, but shortly after, David drops his god-awful, half-assed live stream. Since then, Pika has been 1000% Team Mafia and has not let up in the slightest.
So a quick reflection here. Pika, I know you're going to watch this, so I'm going to talk to you directly. For your sake, I haven't released a word of our private DMs as promised. I'm a man of my word, even if my word is extended to somebody as scummy as you are. Yeah, I've said some seriously derogatory shit. I've crossed the line on more than one occasion. But I take accountability for my bullshit. That's why someone as fucked up as me is as respected as I am in this community. You've crossed the line just as many times as I have. You've made baseless accusations of me and Dewmonic being pedophiles for fucking what? You fucked with Funfair over pronouns. Yet you've gone full SJW over jokes about your ass, taking it as far as calling me fucking sexist and creepy. Where's your accountability for that shit? You can't even take accountability for the fake fucking accounts that we know are you. Let me ask you, why do you think I was chosen to make this segment? The segment directly corresponding to you? Because I'm the only person in this fucking community that doesn't want to rip you a new asshole. To some extent, I did see some good in you. And I should be the last person fucking saying it. You're admittedly highly redeemable if you chose to work with us when I reached out to you.
Alas, you chose to die on this hill, so here's the mudslide, bitch.
The raid on the Dewmonic Abyss server was ultimately the catalyst that sparked this entire battle. Like Breadstick, I honestly do have a degree of sympathy for Pikalove. You know, I'm the type of person who's willing to go above and beyond, to go through hell and back for my friends. As sappy as it is, you know, with all that's happened the past few months, Sayori, Funfair, Breadstick, I consider them family at this point, you know. But as friends, we hold each other accountable. When you see someone you care about engaging in destructive behavior, that's when you step in, intervene, and make sure they have their head screwed on tight. Not make excuses for them. My advice to anyone who could end up in a similar situation as Pika, sometimes you have to step down. I removed her moderator status because it was a conflict of interest having her on my team. It compromised my security. Anyone in my position would not want their private affairs being leaked. I think that's a fair statement to make. I didn't ban and block her immediately, even though I honestly wish I would've. It would've saved me a massive fucking headache. This wasn't even supposed to be a public matter. So, moral of the story, right? If there's a conflict of interest, you have to choose between two groups. You either have to walk away, or you risk burning a bridge. And that's life. And I honestly have a hard time determining whether or not this is a cold, calculated person, willing to go above and beyond to defend what can only be described as predatory behavior for the sake of being able to go to Goofy Gas and take pictures of robot animals, or
if this is someone who's lived a very entitled life and refuses to acknowledge there are consequences for their actions. But regardless, it seems the Mafia shares the same sentiment, as this screenshot, allegedly featuring Travis, was leaked back to me. Oh, I have no doubt Tabby sparked all this. Someone else leaked him stuff later, but she definitely started it. That's why I let them thump on her for weeks, because she needed to learn a lesson. Some people only learn by touching a stove to understand. It's hot. On the 26th of July, Patriot Bill alerted me that Pikalove had brought up the possibility of reaching out to Princess Bubbles. And I think it's fair to say that at least 75% of the people who watch my channel know who Bubbles is and the type of person he brands himself as. Especially considering I've memed on him in literally every single video I've uploaded since March.
I am pissed. I am royally pissed. When I saw this post on Dewmonic and Mrs. community page, I was so disgusted. I fell to the ground, screaming and crying.
When I saw this post on Dewmonic Abyss's community page, I was so disgusted. I fell to the ground screaming and crying. So you can keep pretending that it's just YouTube, and what you say and do doesn't affect anyone outside of it. Maybe I'll adopt your attitude. Because if you think I'm terrible now, it can get much worse.
Princess Bubbles is a self-identified vigilante.
And what Aaron and his gang forget is that I'm a vigilante. I don't answer to Adam, Jacob, Jordan, the law, or anyone else. I represent the Boyd's collective hate and actions. You created me. The only way this persona dies is when you stop feeding it, and I will be the first to dance on its grave.
He will operate numerous fake accounts using his anonymous identity to spread false information that hurts the credibility of Carpetbaggers Detractors. He has openly admitted to doxing numerous content creators across the bottom of YouTube.
With my research, I find like a lot of these trolls, they don't really have a whole lot to lose, you know, especially when I was doxing people. I think the fantasy was, you know, people in your real life are going to find out what you've been doing and what a terrible person you are, and maybe you'll lose your job or something.
And with me, it got to the point where I had to contact a Virginia police department after Antiques in Motion had uploaded a rather unhinged video featuring a firearm in response to my livestream.
I see this Frank Castle guy as your new hero. I'm going to tell you, I'm not like Steven.
And this was an event Pikalove was around for. She's well aware the type of person Bubbles is. Flash forward a few months, it is now September 15th. I emailed Princess Bubbles a deepfake meme created by Lord Taco. This meme features Carpetbagger and Antiques in Motion singing, "I love you, baby.
I love you, baby. I'm just part of what I need, baby. You are the lonely night, baby."
Well, an obnoxious Pikalove watermark flashes across the screen, courtesy of yours truly. Now, for context, this was a meme that sparked from Sayori clowning on Pika for watermarking pictures and footage she doesn't own. And I added fuel to that fire, obviously being Dewmonic Abyss, by putting that watermark on literally everything. A bit of an irrelevant detail, but I found it pretty interesting how all of these pieces unintentionally managed to fall together. Princess Bubbles responds by sending me a screenshot from an unidentifiable individual because the profile picture has been censored, and this screenshot came from Reddit. The screenshot is in reference to a false narrative Bubbles had put out, which will be explained and debunked later on in this video. Bubbles tells me that three people from the animatronic community reached out to him. Also of note is that he mentions him and several other content creators, presumably in the Carpetbagger Adam the Moose circle, find the community to be too toxic. when I personally pressed for the names of the people who reached out to him, even explaining how dire the situation was, Bubbles refused to comment. 4 days later, Travis, aka Veganova, launches a brutal smear campaign on Instagram, referencing the same exact post on Reddit. So I was perusing Reddit looking for festive fall recipes and stumbled upon this. I'd use the term unbelievable, but actually it makes sense of a lot of things. I don't know who or what a Princess Bubbles is, and I don't care. Normally banter like this is rightfully disregarded, but when someone goes full Fector in their response, it tells me a nerve was hit. Hashtag never go full Fector. Hashtag doing the math. Hashtag sus fuck. Hashtag end me. It is of my opinion that Travis sourcing Bubbles should have been a massive red flag, and for a lot of people it honestly was. But Travis isn't appealing to my community with this Instagram post. He's appealing to children, and he's appealing to the quote-unquote normies who don't keep up with any amount of internet drama. They don't know who Dewmonic Abyss even is. And, you know, to Travis's credit, he succeeded. The post got well over 100 likes, people were blocking me based on this unsubstantiated claim, and members of the community were flocking together en masse to defend David. Only a portion of them actually knowing that he had been grooming a 14-year-old. Travis claims that he doesn't know who Bubbles is. And if you've been paying attention so far, well, you don't need me to explain to you that's a heaping help of fucking bullshit, but if we are to take his claim at face value, it shows Travis hasn't put even the slightest amount of research into who I am and the topics I cover. As Funfair even stated earlier, he is simply projecting David's acts of pedophilia onto me to try and manipulate the narrative. Now I want to properly debunk the allegation Bubbles made about me on the Adam LeBlue subreddit. First and foremost, he makes the claim that I included a clip of Anthony, aka Wally and Tony, talking about a 13-year-old girl's panties. Well, in typical Princess Bubbles fashion, this was a joke taken out of context, peppered in with a weird lie. First of all, Bubbles claims that Jacob's daughter is 13. This is false. And you can let Jacob himself personally debunk that.
Anna was born in September, and actually Hurricane Ivan was coming through the mountains at that time. It rained for days and days and days.
As you've just heard, she was born during Hurricane Ivan, which occurred in 2004. No one born in 2004 would be 13 years old in 2020. Last year, I uploaded a video criticizing how Carpetbagger was handling the pandemic, flocking to Pigeon Forge immediately as it reopens. A point of contention I made was that he wasn't taking the face mask mandate seriously. Anthony recorded a skit with his Carpetbagger doll, the first one Fector had ever sold, and the doll that single-handedly sparked a wildfire of drama in the Rockafire community. I'm going to play the skit for you in its entirety so you can see the full context for yourself.
Jacob, I know Pigeon Forge just opened, and I've been stuck in the house for 3 weeks with a wife and child. You don't get it. We all get it. Hey, I see you got all your supplies. You know you have to actually wear the mask? What the fuck is that made of? Okay, and you have to use the hand sanitizer. I need to go ride a merry-go-round. I bet you just sit on a fucking bench, dude. Yeah, going up and down is way too strenuous now. I haven't been doing my wrestling training.
Jacob, the mask won't help you if it's just in a bag. Dude, did you make that out of your daughter's panties?
Yeah, well, I mean, we can't sell them right now because of the fucking COVID. How am I supposed to be buying my diabetes almonds? Don't you know I got gout now?
As you can see, it was a passing joke in a skit mocking how Jacob handled the pandemic. The point of the joke was to portray Jacob as a money-hungry person who'd be willing to root through his daughter's clothing and sell them as face masks. I didn't write this script, and I personally didn't see anything suggestive about it when I was editing my video. I doubt there was any intent behind Anthony saying it either. If it's a joke that doesn't sit right with you, that's your prerogative. But anyone with half a brain cell can obviously see the context isn't what Bubbles made it out to be. It's a joke. It's that simple. The second part of Bubbles' very flimsy, half-baked allegation is that I was catfished by a 12-year-old girl. Now,
I find the notion of people taking bubbles seriously in 2021 absolutely fucking ridiculous, but I have to explain this because Travis pushed this false narrative out to over 100 people, a lot of them being normies, like I said, that aren't too involved in the drama sphere. Anyone who's been watching my channel since 2019 knows that this is just a blatant lie. My girlfriend at the time was 19, about the same age I was, you know, give or take a few months. When I confronted Bubbles about Travis sourcing his lie, he admitted to me that he was basically talking out of his ass. You know, again, typical Bubbles fashion. He does reference a conversation, and that conversation he's referring to was a threat of defamation Jacob the Carpetbagger had made to me following the meltdown he had after I uploaded the famous Intervention Carpetbagger. The reason I uploaded this screenshot was because I knew that was the narrative Jacob and Bubbles were going to push, as they've done to numerous other creators, primarily Wally and Tony. They've slandered him pretty fucking hard to the point where Carpetbagger put out this ridiculous documentary acting like Anthony was going to murder him and his family.
I am creating this video as a documentation of this harassment. I want this to be a record. If something were to happen to me or my family, if we were killed or something.
And obviously, I was right. I made the right call here because I'm still having to debunk this bullshit years later. Let me make something clear. I've never talked to Jacob on any personal level, and him presuming to know my ex-partner better than I do is fucking bonkers. That was a comment he made in a fit of fucking rage. This has always been the silver bullet go-to, primarily by the fucking boomers of YouTube. It's what they bring up anytime they try to swing at good old Dewmonic Abyss. And you want to know the reason why? It's because it led to me becoming iPad's boy. So why am I opening up this wound again? Because I'm not going to let it be weaponized against me by some greasy man-child in a Subis Pizza Place t-shirt. It was January 2019. I'd worked my ass off at McDonald's, grilling burgers, making sandwiches, saving up just over $1,000. And I was in a long-distance relationship. By long distance, I mean literally just a couple states away. Nothing crazy, nothing unrealistic. If you've seen the name Claire pop up a few times, that's who people are referring to. Claire was tragically a victim of assault. It was a big part of why she'd felt more comfortable dating online than in person. And that was something I tried to be patient and understanding towards. You know, me, the reason why I date online is because the women in my town have zero fucking personality, you know. People ditch this town the first chance they get. You know, when I head out to the bar, I legit don't meet anyone worth bringing home. You know, maybe I'll see a biker dude in a fucking, with a long scruffy gray beard. But obviously, I'm not trying to get in his fucking pants. The reason people call her a catfish is because she lied about where she lived. Me, personally, I see catfishing as a malicious thing, you know. When you catfish someone, you're luring them in to either get dirt on them, you know, blackmail, or you're trying to get money off them. It wasn't either of those things. It was a genuine relationship. The only thing she lied about was where she lived. Honestly, I just saw this as us both being two dumb 19-year-olds. It really doesn't go any deeper than that. But this ended up with me going to Ohio for a few days, hoping to see someone who realistically wasn't there. While I was on the road, she told me she was in the hospital, you know, and that her family would be picking me up from the bus station. Because I took a Greyhound there, you know? Fair enough, right? But they never came. So I made the decision to haul ass and walked an hour through freezing winter rain to that hospital, backpack over my shoulders, dragging luggage behind me. Alright? So it got fucking intense. And everything snowballed from there.
And then something horrible happened. It was tragic. She was coming to pick me up and she got in a car crash. And she died. It was horrible. There was blood everywhere. Everywhere. It was all my fault. I killed my girlfriend's mother.
Listen, alright. I'm Dewmonic Abyss. I've pissed a lot of people off. And this was the first and really one of the only times they've smelled blood like this in the water. And when they did, they took the opportunity to capitalize. They succeeded in getting me to leave YouTube for a bit. I want to say maybe a couple weeks. I don't remember exactly. It was years ago. But I wasn't in any mental state to handle being fucking dogpiled by half the bottom of YouTube. And reasonably so, okay? You know, I went to Ohio excited by the prospect of fucking traveling. I've been in Pennsylvania really most of my life. And Marietta was honestly a pretty town, you know? I wanted to get some vlogs out there, you know? And then when I finally noticed things were spiraling out of control, I was like, oh fuck, oh no, can I take this back? I took that time to reflect on shit. I realized I needed to come back stronger. I realized I was tired of taking everyone's shit. I realized I was gonna fight back. And when I did come back, I came back with this eye patch. And to me, it's supposed to be a personal reminder of the darkness I had in me. And a reminder of the battles I've fought. A reminder that you don't just end things when shit gets tough. You stick it out, and you help the people you care about, no matter how many bullets you end up taking in the process. And that's why I can understand the length Travis and Pika have gone to lie, defend, and cover for their friend. I'm just as resilient of a person, if not more. And this is how far I was willing to go for someone who I thought needed me. And this video is how far I've been willing to go for a 14-year-old who's being victimized, and for my friends who have been fucked with for helping me investigate. And the person who tried to groom this 14-year-old is the person the mafia is standing by. You'd actually be surprised by how many people I've came across that are genuinely afraid of this guy, that are genuinely afraid of being harassed by the Rockafire Mafia. But you want to know something? I'm not. So keep firing at me, motherfuckers. If you want to see just how unhinged Travis has become in trying to defend David and the Mafia's reputation, I want you to take a close look at this Instagram post. I'd called out David over a flirtatious comment he left on a minor's post, and this is the same minor he attempted to solicit a topless photograph of. Dewmonic, stalking a minor's profile, and then running scared when called out on it. Also, to answer his question, he's quoting the song! Jesus fucking Christ! Tell me you know nothing about the Rockafire without telling me you know nothing about the Rockafire. Any fan with half a clue would have gotten the reference. But keep running with this, just like you run from the people calling you out. Thankfully, this is when Travis started receiving some pushback from the community.
1. He got it from a viewer in a Rockafire drama server. Doesn't take a private investigator to find a comment of a grown man hitting on a child. 2. Grown men don't flex how much they know about the fucking Rockafire unless they're trying to appeal to the 9-year-olds in their Instagram following. If you paid a lick of attention to who Dewmonic Abyss is, you know he's not a Rockafire YouTuber. 3. Quoting a song, telling someone they look good, is still flirting. Even worse, doing it under a 14-year-old kid's post, regardless of if it's from a song. Fucking jackasses. When are you ever gonna hold your friends accountable? I know my friends don't groom kids. Evidence. Stone cold evidence shows that your buddy clearly has a habit of hitting on little kids on the internet. You can't Uno reverse card your way out of this forever.
Triggered? Man, why don't you go back to having cyber sex with Pedo Fox again and again? You're the only dude I've ever known who worked to expose a pedo that everyone already knew was one, just so you could cyber fuck him. We know you love the cyber with pedos, but sorry to burst your bubble, we're not your type.
At Veganova, your roasting game could not have backfired more. LMAO. You just said we when referencing fucking pedophiles. I didn't work to expose Pedo Fox. I worked to get an audience with him, to confront him. At what point is confronting a pedophile a bad thing? If you don't know the slightest thing about my personal life, lad, I'll seduce your mother out of spite, you fucking pumpkin seed.
Not a lot, but many of us were watching him manipulate this narrative in real time. I do want to point out the obvious hypocrisy in this statement, as stalking minors and their families is something Travis is rather notorious for himself. I want to wrap up this video by transitioning into the very point I started off with. Travis claims that I, Dewmonic Abyss, was a mafia pawn from day one. unwittingly doing exactly what they needed me to do in the entire grand scheme of things. And while I'm not exactly surprised by the idea that the Rockafire Mafia uses people in the community and discards them twice as fast, I think you've heavily underestimated myself, my team who has been working their asses off and helping bring this all to light, and the entire fandom as a whole. I have enough influence in this community that members of your own mafia group were willing to sell you out. And not for any type of personal gain, not for popularity, not for money, but because they knew it was the right thing to do. The truth of the matter is, the mafia has been gatekeeping the community since the very beginning. Whenever someone threatens their assets or their ideals, they organize witch hunts behind the scenes. Commentary channels, people with a voice and a platform, threaten their power and control. In some alternate timeline where myself, Sayori, Breadstick, and Funfair ceased to exist, Andrea and Bobby would have never experienced their fall from grace.
Cavity Sam! Kinda cringe.
As Pikalove revealed, Andrea was a mafia asset, talking to David under Fector's nose. Pete Fox would be a name very few people in the community recognize. Sure, maybe the Mafia would have eventually put out an Instagram statement about him, but a couple hundred followers is never going to compare to the thousands of people that are now aware of the tactics he uses to manipulate minors into doing what he wants. And unlike David, we ended up strong-arming Pete into publicly taking accountability for what he's done.
Okay, I'm going to break this down, and I want you to let this sink into your soul, son. Pete, you are a pedophile. I want you to take that message deep into your fucking soul.
And you know what else? There would be a 14, 15-year-old girl out there right now, knowing this truth about David, forced to suffer in silence, while the mafia sits on their asses, pretending nothing is happening, because they need their program blue, because they need their goofy gas.
This song right here is dedicated to Dewmonic Piss.
Straight from the Mafia!
This entire situation has shown me that, ultimately, Aaron Fector is the best hope for the future of the Rockafire explosion, and he needs to be put back on the top of his own creation. I mean, he might be eccentric, but never in the 2 years of me investigating him, the 2 years of fighting with him, have I seen anything come out about him grooming his fans. And from the limited conversations I've had with him, I can tell Aaron is someone who cares deeply about his brand. And he's personally told me he's reflected on a lot of the criticism I've given him in his time away from the public spotlight.
And now, as I release them, for better or for worse, my luck will turn around. Good luck always, Aaron Fector. Very kind letter. I greatly appreciate that. I'll be hanging this on my refrigerator.
You know, I'm not gonna bullshit you. A lot of the drama and the banner and the trolling was fun.
Alright guys, so this is what I look like with my official Aaron Fector brand do-it-yourself face mask.
But here we have it. The creative engineering song.
It's elastic. You can use it as like a slingshot, I guess.
You know, I completely own the fucking iPads boy thing. I've completely owned being the fucking king of the cockroaches. And I think it's a good thing the community was willing to call him out when it was necessary. But you know what I want at the end of all this? I want there to be a happy conclusion to the Rockafire explosion. Because there are kids out there, plenty of them, who idolize these characters, who idolize Fector.
Happy birthday, Caleb! One of my treasured premium subscribers!
And they don't need their hearts broken. They need their hero back. And I hope he rises up above these mafia bastards. I hope he's willing to work with us and the community to steer this ship in the right direction.
One thing I would like to make very clear is shout out to Dewmonic Abyss. Because me? I'm setting landmines, I'm making catfish accounts to try to get these pedophiles. This man has been sleeplessly investigating his fucking fingertips off
on this entire problem by himself. There's nothing I can do to get to the level of investment this man has put into this whole situation. This is why he's my brother. This is why he gets the respect he gets from me and the community. Not just the animatronic community, every fucking community he has planted his roots in.